Welcome to another episode on Know Thyself, a program that enriches your knowledge. In fact, yes, the Word of God says in Hosea 4:6 that my people perish because of the lack of knowledge. So we are aimed at giving that knowledge so that you will know the truth and set yourselves free. We have with us the experts, Father Michael Karimattam, who teaches scriptural theology also at the Mary Mata Seminary. And also we have Sister Glorista, who is a doctor in counseling and also trains counselors. Welcome, Father.
Thank you.
Welcome, Sister. So we will be continuing to discuss even more. Today, we're going to speak about this story of this prodigal son. Yes, Father. Who is this prodigal son? What happened?
Yeah, we have been so far focusing on Jesus' attitude towards women. It's many episodes we have gone through. But Jesus has more to tell about the Father. Mm-hmm. Because Jesus came to reveal God, who is the Father and Mother. And Jesus has done it through many parables. The parable, the word parabole, it comes from parabolein, to put side by side, like a parallel rail tracks. No? Oh. So you put a earthly reality parallel to a heavenly reality to interpret, to explain. Wonderful. So what is seen here is seen also true as the other. That is a parable. So you put a heavenly reality parallel to the earthly. So the earthly reality is seen, understood, and from the known you go to the unknown. Mm-hmm. So Jesus is telling stories to explain something profound.
Nice.
So that's what you call the parables of Jesus. And here, I don't go into the details of the parables, but here we have a parable about God. In fact, there are three parables in the Gospel of Luke, chapter 15. It's called very often the Gospel of Gospels, the nutshell of Gospels, so to say. There are three stories. Usually we call one story is the lost sheep, mm-hmm. the other is the lost coin, and the lost son. But that is only partial understanding. In fact, the central figure is neither the lost sheep, nor the lost coin, nor the lost son, but the one who searches, seeks. Mm. So Jesus is presenting God as the one who is seeking the lost. For example, the first question God asked to man, remember?
Where are you?
Paradise. So he's searching for the lost. So right from the beginning, God is searching for the lost. So that is somehow interpreted in a story form. So there are three stories, and the two we just leave here is the more important and maybe the best classic parable in the world, so to say. So there are two sons, and I think first we'll focus on the first son. So I'll read first so that the explanation will be easier. Mm-hmm. The whole gospel starts like this, Gospel of Luke chapter 15 verses 1 and 2. Now the tax collectors and sinners were all drawing near to him. And the Pharisees and the scribes murmured saying, "This man receives sinners and eats with them." Mm-hmm. So the context is very important to understand the text. So the context is that of criticism. So Jesus is being criticized for keeping company with the sinners, the publicans. And there are people who grudge, who complain, who criticize, because this man receives sinners and eats with them. Mm. So this is the situation. So now, why does Jesus do that? And who is this criticizing? Why are they criticizing? So he has the question of the lost sheep and the son and the coin. We come to the son, the first part. And he said, there was a man who had two sons. And the younger of them said to the father, "Father, give to me the share of the property that falls to me." And he divided his living between them. Not many days later, the younger son gathered all he had and took his journey into a far country, and there he squandered his property in loose living. And when he had spent everything, a great famine arose in the country, and he began to be in want. So he went and joined himself to one of the citizens of the country, who sent him into his fields to feed swine. And he would gladly have fed on the pods that the swine ate, and no one gave him anything. But when he came to himself, he said, "How many of my father's hired servants have bread enough and to spare, but I perish here with hunger? I'll arise and go to my father, and I'll say to him, 'Father, I have sinned against heaven and before you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son. Treat me as one of your hired servants.' And so he rose and came to his father. But while he was yet a distance, his father saw him, and he had compassion, and ran and embraced him and kissed him. And the son said to him, 'Father, I have sinned against heaven and before you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son.' But the father said to his servants, 'Bring quickly the best robe, put it on him, and put a ring on his hand and shoes on his feet. And bring the fatted calf and kill it, and let us eat and make merry. For this son was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found.' And they began to make merry." So this is the story. Here we have two main characters, the father and the son. In fact, what you say about the prodigal son, this is put in two verses. He collected everything and he went and squandered and left everything. That is only beginning. Then goes on the story. Jesus is somehow telling the story of a person who lost himself, who thought he was not free at his father's house. So he thought far away from the father he would be happy. But then for a moment he was happy, in fact. At least he had his pleasures. He thought he would be free, he would be happy having his own way. But then as long as the funds were there, there were friends. But once he has no more funds, you know, there's no more friend, and he began to starve. So this is a very drastic, very clear picture. And then he is an Israelite. He goes into a foreign country. And then in order to make a living, he goes to the farmer, and the farmer sends him to the field to feed the pigs. And even food he doesn't get. So Jesus is telling, narrating a story how the degradation of a person, how far it can go. So going away from the father's house, at the father's house he felt he was not free. But now he is in the pig stall and he is hungry and lost of all his dignity. For a Jew, for an Israelite to be in contact with the pigs is totally inadmissible. He has become contaminated, he is unclean and hungry and starving. Mm-hmm. And now then he thinks about his fathers. Though in the, at the bottom of his misery, he thinks about his fathers, not of father's love, mm-hmm. but father's food. Mm-hmm. So this is a very selfish person. He doesn't care about the father's love or anything. He just wants to get food. How many hired servants in my father's house, they have their plenty and more. So now I go and tell, I'm no more worthy to be a son. I don't dare because I have lost. So the moment you get your share from the father, the degradation is over. So normally in the time of Jesus in Palestine, the property will be shared with the children only after the death of the father. So the fact that this son asks for his property, for him the father is dead. It's no more. I don't want to be. Mm. And now he comes. He's afraid. He doesn't believe that he can be anymore called a son. Only to be a hired servant. What does he want? He wants protection, he wants food, that's all. Nothing more. So the love of the father doesn't attract him. It's only compassion. He wants to live, that's all. Such a misery. And then you see the contrast. So this is not the center. Here, I think Jesus is explaining the situation of a sinner. And then the center of the picture is not the sinner, the father. You see, very interesting to note the indication. The father saw him from far away. Mm. So it would seem from the moment that the son left home, the father was sitting there at the veranda gate watching, when will he come? When will he come? So the son came to himself of his awareness, of his selfishness, of his fallen now, and now he thinks he gets his food, and then he comes and he tries to make the declamation, the sermon or the poem he has made. Father, I have sinned against you and against heaven, and I am no more worthy to be called your son. Enough. Enough, don't talk anymore, the father said. I know. Mm-hmm. I'm happy that you came back. Enough. Whatever has happened, let us forget. So this is how God takes. Now wash him, clean him, put him new cloth, and put a ring on his finger. He's become the heir of mine. And he has put shoes on the feet, that he's no more a slave. He only the patron, the lords have the right to wear shoes in the house. So he is allowed to wear shoes, and he is taken with the full right. Not only that, then he rejoices. So that is how Jesus, there is a joy in heaven. Later on, Jesus will say there will be more joy in heaven about one sinner who repents than 199 who do not. So here there is a joy. So what is Jesus telling? Telling what is important is realize your dignity, who you are, and what it means to be with the Father. So God is not a tyrant, nor God is not a cruel judge. He is a loving Father waiting for you. He's so sad and unhappy that you go away. But whatever be the situation you come in, he'll take. So this is a picture, Jesus' pains of the Father. And here I think we have the most beautiful confession. And what God wants is not the words you speak out, that you come back. So that is first thing. I think sister will have more to say about this, how it deals with the person, the picture, Jesus' pains of this sinner, and how it is today in a normal relationship.
One way we can say the father is the prodigal one, because he is lavishing love. And this is unconditional love. No matter what you did, I love you. I care for you. And this is the message God the Father giving us in that sense. It's not the, you're saying that even if your sins are scarlet, it will be washed white. Because it is that love. And regarding the son, we can say it's always misery that allows us to encounter the truth. Suffering has the value of suffering. As long as he had money and he had was, in a way he was buying friends. But the money he had, when you have money, a lot of people will come, in your misery, no companions. And then you are, when he has finished his money, nobody is there anymore, no friends. None of these friends who feasted with him had any kind of heart or care to give him anything. So he had to go to the limits of his degradation in the sense to be in the pig's farm. Even there, he did not have any food in that sense. So he had come to a real fall. And when it is that fall, in the sense you become aware of yourself. From where I have fallen, he saw that. And then he dares to return to the Father. He's not sure whether the Father will accept him or not, anything, but anyway he decided to go back. He felt any condition in the home is better than this feeding the sheep, feeding the pigs. And so that is a return. And Jesus was emphasizing, this father is not the one who is keeping tag of the mistakes you did, but the fact you are the son and you have returned. And this is part of our lives in that sense. There is a person who is trying to go haywire in all of us. And it is, you know, I want to be free. I want to do anything I want to do. It's a tendency we all have. Sometimes we feel restricted, but at the same time, just let go. And that's what he did. This tendency is with everybody. It's part of our personality in the sense. And there is something, this is why God has put conscience in us. when we go wrong, don't go that way. This is a way of disaster. Jesus said, come through the narrow path. It is a little bit difficult to walk through that path.
Mm.
But always the tendency is with us, in the sense, to go whichever way I want to. And Freud says there is two forces within us. One is pulling us to life, the other one is to death. Whichever the force wins, that is what it means. And in this case, his force was really to go free, and he did. Even though it was a path to disaster, he followed it and went and really fell to the pit. And that woke him up.
Mm.
Sometimes it's like getting a slap.
Wait, shaken up, like, yeah.
Shaken up. He was shocked to see that to the extent where he had come to. And that is a rude awakening in the sense of coming to reality. And that is there is another side is saying that putting all the restrictions on me. I'm not allowed to, because there are some people say, I'm not supposed to watch TV. I'm not supposed to watch a movie. I'm not supposed to eat anything that I would enjoy. I'm not supposed to do this and that. They will not give themselves freedom to do anything they want. And that also will be crippling.
Before you go to this restriction, what about what I would like to do is say something more about the suffering. So you said the suffering plays an important role in self-realization. That's
yes.
What.
Yes.
True.
Maybe yeah. Something that you could say something more about it.
In the more, see, when we go away from the path you are supposed to, there is an inner conflict in that sense happens. And when we are really if we ignore that and go on, there will be the mistake in the sense it will cause us suffering. Suffering is something we try to avoid all the time because we don't. But suffering has a value to bring us to the reality. When there is suffering, the inflated ego is shrunk and we become open to listen to others. Even when children will do that in the sense, we tell the children to do this and that and everything else, they will not listen to you.
So do you think the suffering was caused by the father, this boy?
No. The suffering was caused by his own action. He demanded from the father his share. And he was not thinking about anybody else but himself. And that is, he's saying, I have the property, now I have the money, I am the big one, I have everybody. I have all the friends I can get. But they all came together, they ate, drank, had merry, the money ran out. He did not care whether he had it. See, he did not even think, when this money is over, what will happen to me?
Right.
Can't we also something say about the need of law, discipline? Because the house of the father meant discipline. He had to obey this and that and what. He didn't have the freedom.
Yeah.
And now, once he has the freedom, he becomes a slave. So can you perhaps...
It's like a decorum in the identity.
There is a freedom in the sense of two way of looking at freedom. Freedom to do anything you feel like doing, but freedom to do what you have to do. He had the freedom to do what he had to do, but he was not satisfied with that. He wanted the freedom to do whatever he felt like doing. And that is the erroneous way of looking at freedom in that sense.
Maybe can you say this freedom is a kind of slavery to your emotions and feelings? You become it's your inner power. So on the one side, you feel that you are limited by the laws imposed on you, in the father's house, the Torah, and all the rest. On the other hand, you have your emotions, your likings, your desires. So either you feel free, as enslaved to the father's law, or you become a slave of your own emotions.
Again, I think it is an attitude.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? I am in a congregation. We have certain laws and regulations and things like that. If I think they are all restricting me, then I am not free.
Mm-hmm.
If I think they are my guidelines in my life to keep my obedience, my sense of poverty, and my sense of celibacy, then it will become be a freeing force for me.
Mm.
Because with this comes also the protection of the congregation.
Here I think we have this one word that Jesus has said. He came to himself.
Mm.
There comes the realization. Realization of who I am. How did I end up here? Then he thinks about the Father. My God, how happy I was in my Father's house.
Mm.
So he comes to himself. That is a self-realization. So in the self-realization process, I think this also plays a role, that sin. Not that sin was necessary, but the going away and the impact and the result made him aware of the greatness of the love of the Father. So if he was never out, he would always think, well, I can't do that. I am restricted. I have no freedom. Now he has experienced the freedom and he has seen how miserable it makes you. So it's not a freedom. It is a laxitude or whatever you want to call it. It makes you a slave of your own emotions. So for that, if to be free, as you said in the beginning, know thyself. You should know who you are.
Very true.
So unless you know who you are, you will not be free. Jesus said, if you abide in my word, you will know the truth and the truth will make you free. So the truth is that you are a son of God. And you are loved by God. And as long as you are here, you are safe. All the commandments. So the commandments we have a tendency to consider as a burden. The Ten Commandments. And very often it would seem God has made a barrier, a fence around himself to protect himself from the sins. But it's not God protecting himself. We are being protected. For example, the first commandment.
Right.
I am the Lord your God who brought you out of the land of slavery, out of Egypt. You shall have no other God besides me. Not because God will lose something. If you have some other God besides me, you will become a slave to that God.
Right.
I am the God who gives you freedom.
And so, he came to that awareness through suffering. His hunger, his nobody is there, no more the friends who were roaming around him. Nobody was there for him. The enjoyment was over.
So when you get out of the house and do whatever I feel like, I am free. It's an illusion. So then you are not aware of yourself. So when at the depth of the suffering, you become really aware. My God, how have I ended up here? Now the only way is going back. That is what you call the metanoia, a return. That's why the prophets were saying, come back, shub, they call it in Hebrew. Shub, come back, you unfaithful Israel, come back. And the prophet you quoted, Hosea. Hosea had a wife, and she thought the life with this strange prophet was so binding. She, after three children, she ran away, and then she became slave. And Hosea went after her and liberated, brought her back, and then come. Now you shall remain faithful. Unless you do that, you'll be slave again. So I think this is the realization this boy made. That's what Jesus is telling. So living in the Father's house, that is not restriction. That is freedom. It gives you the environment.
Right.
It gives you the environment. It is something like having a well in the compound of a nursery school. So if there is a wall around the well, the children are free, the teacher is free. You can play around. But if the well is open and no fence, the teacher will have no peace, the children will play and they feel the. So the commandments, the rules, the restrictions are fence around the pitfalls, around the wells. So the well or the commandments are to be seen not as a restriction, but as way to liberation. So without law, without restriction, there will be no freedom. Mm-hmm. But you see, for example, I have been driving yesterday. So we have a law that you have to drive on the left side, left-hand side. But many people come on the other side. So if everybody is keeping the law, there will be very few accidents. Once in a while, I go to Europe once a year or so. I see so few accidents in the European, so many more cars and so faster roads. But here, I can't drive for 10 minutes without seeing an accident.
Mm.
Why? Because here, people are free. You drive where you want, no law.
Mm.
You are your own law, and everybody takes the law into one's own hand, no freedom. So I think this is what the lawlessness is, doesn't give you freedom.
Illusion of freedom. Yeah.
What is that?
It is an illusion of freedom.
Yeah. Mm. And that makes you aware of, and finally, so many accidents, but we don't learn from that. In the story of the prodigal son, he learned the lesson. He learned the lesson in a bitter way, but then he remained. So there is a strain, there is a change in the person. That is the more important thing. No? When he became aware of his misery, and comparing it to the love, joy, the happiness he had at his house, he goes back.
So it's more or less he finds two identities and then he chooses the right one. So that was a great insight in understanding oneself through the life of the prodigal son. We have much more to learn to know who we are in Christ, to know what we are called to do. We will be discussing in the upcoming episodes. If you have any questions, you can write to knowthyselfdtv@gmail.com. Till we meet you in another episode, God bless you. Thank you, Father.